And we're going to be talking about our latest book entitled Asian American Scholars of Education, subtitled 21st Century Pedagogies, Perspectives, and Experiences. And I just like to point out there's a reason why we're calling it 21st Century Pedagogies, Perspectives, and Experiences. And it pertains to the fact that in our research in the book, we highlight and document the fact that in the 2000s, that's the time when Asian Americans started receiving distinguished professorships and endowed professorships. And so it's intentional. So I'm an associate professor and department chair at Metropolitan State University in the School of Urban Education. My department's early childhood and elementary education. And I also serve as the program coordinator of our graduate program.
And I am an assistant professor of criminal justice at Roanoke College. That's in the Department of Public Affairs. You may notice and wonder with curiosity about this photo. So you'll see I'm right there in the middle with the white and black scarf and the glasses. And so I've recently instituted at my college an inside-out prison exchange program. And so just to explain the photo, this is where I bring 10 of my traditional Roanoke College students to the jail, which happens to be very close to campus, so we can walk. And they take a college course throughout the entire semester with 10 jail inmates. The course this semester is entitled Special Topics in Criminology, and everyone in the room, everyone in the class, gets course credit for their experience. And so we think of this as really transformational education and allowing insiders to experience the outside world and vice versa.
And when you were at Framingham State, you were doing prison work and I got to visit. And so that we've been collaborating for quite some time now. We've done other books. And our research aligns and intersects in many different ways around Asian American model minority stereotype characterizations and deviance and what have you. So
we're going to start by talking about some of the research that led up to the current volume that we're focusing on today. And so we're going to discuss two related projects. The first is an article that was published in Educational Studies several years ago. And so this article explores endowed chairs and distinguished professors in the field of education. And so what this project does is it begs the question, who gets these coveted positions? What role do these coveted positions play in bringing up the next generation of scholars? And how diverse are these coveted positions? And so we hypothesize, before starting the study, that they're not diverse and that white male from prestigious graduate programs will be most likely A, to hold these positions currently, and B, to mentor people similar to them. And so our results indicate that very thing. There are two theoretical schools of thought that inform the project. The first is social network theory. And so this is the idea that people occupy their social networks with other people similar to them, and that our social networks are meaningful, right? So who we know impacts our experiences, our bodies of knowledge, our interactions, the people that we mentor, what have you. Also related to this is this concept of homophily that McPherson et al. Set forth. And this is essentially the idea that birds of a feather flock together. And so our findings from this project suggest that to be true, that people who currently hold these coveted positions are bringing up others very similar to themselves. What's problematic about that is that it's recreating the status quo. And so one of the things we do in our recommendations at the end of the article is set forth ideas about how to change this pattern. So especially if we have a wave of academics or scholars who are nearing retirement in the next 5-10 years, what can we do proactively to make sure that the status quo is not recreated in the manner that it would be if there's no intervention?
Yeah, and we update this analysis with new data. And what we found is in our original study in 2016, females were statistically significantly less likely to have these positions. But now in our updated analysis, there is no statistical significant difference. So arguably that is a good development. And to Daisy's point, I can think of a mentor of mine, she's African American, but Gloria Latson Billings, recently retired from University of Wisconsin-Madison, has a Kellner endowed chair, I don't know the official title, retired, but I'm not sure who has who has her position, or if they close that position. But again, to Daisy's point, who will replace that position? Will it be diverse? Will it remain diverse, or will someone else occupy it? Our study looked at education. Because I'm biased, I'm in the field of education, and we know that Asian Americans are underrepresented in the K-12 spaces as teachers, as school leaders, principals, but then also they are underrepresented in many respects in the field of education, like teacher educators. Yes, you might find them in statistics departments, in psychology, ed psychology, but there are not enough of us, let's put it that way. And so that's really what we did. And in that study, we looked not just at Asian Americans, we looked at all endowed and distinguished professors in education. And what we discovered is that white men in this field had a preponderance of these positions. They were overwhelmingly white, male, and older scholars. Which makes sense, because typically to reach that level, that pinnacle, you have to first be an assistant professor, climb the ranks to associate, climb the ranks to full, and then have done enough scholarly work to obtain that title. We also found that Asian Americans were underrepresented, and they only began to receive these positions in the 2000s, because we tracked the decades in which they received these positions in the 1960s, 1970s, 1980s, 1990s, and then 2000s. Certainly we found that women were underrepresented as well, across the board. Didn't matter what race, women. Which makes sense again. We know how higher education is sexist and patriarchal, and how these systems disserve female scholars. Among other things, we looked at the prestige of the professors, where they got their terminal degrees. Were they PhDs or EdDs? How long they took to obtain these, again, going to the point of assistant associate. How many years it took to receive those positions. And we found that Asian Americans received their titles quicker in less years than, say, white scholars. We also noticed that no one had really done specifically studies like this that really looked at different racial groups, specifically in the field of education. There were studies in other disciplines like marketing, law, medicine, you know, different fields. But in terms of education, there weren't. At about the time of getting our paper submitted for peer review, a book was published right here to the right. And it was entitled Reaching the Mountaintop of the Academy, subtitled Personal Narratives, Advice, and Strategies from Black Distinguished and Endowed Professors. And we thought, oh, marvelous. They were chapters. It was an edited book where Black professors talked about their triumphs and their tragedies in terms of reaching the mountaintop, so to speak. And so I'm sharing all of this, again, how this is the origin story, because in the back of my mind, as a scholar, right, as scholars, we're continuing to ask questions. My mind is churning. Oh, I see that there are very few Asian American scholars who have this title. Oh, I'm noticing these patterns. And so the book that's now out, I originally had planned to interview all of the endowed chairs and distinguished professors that we had found in the national study, because there's so few of us, I think at the time there were maybe nine, I wanted to just literally reach out to them, right? So I wrote an IRB, got approval, got funding. I got seed money from the institution at the time, Illinois State. I had made a visit to UConn, where I interviewed George Sugai, and I had reached out and met with Asha Jitendra, who was then a professor at the University of Minnesota Twin Cities, at a conference in Chicago. And so I had two down, you know, seven to go, and I was making headway, and then I moved institutions, the money ran out, and I'm like, gotta deviate, change the project. And this study was, you have the title there, Homophily in Higher Education, Historicizing the AERA Member to Fellow Pipeline Using Theories of Social Reproduction and Social Networks. That's a fancy title to say, we looked at the American Education Research Association, that's the acronym AERA, which is the premier educational conference for ed researchers. And AERA has a program where they name people fellows. It's a very rigorous process. You have to be nominated by AERA fellows. You get vetted. Only a handful each year are named AERA fellows. And the mission behind the AERA fellows on paper is to increase the interdisciplinarity of exceptional researchers. We were interested in looking at the composition of these fellows. Because again, I'm like, endowed professors, very small amount are Asians. I suspect there's going to be very few AERA fellows, which we found true. But homophily is a sociological term for birds of a feather flock together. And so we wanted to utilize this theory and framework to examine and explain this phenomenon. And so an idea came, a light bulb came on. And it was this idea of, well, going back to the first study, if there are so few of us, well, why is that? Well, it could be because there aren't enough there to begin with to mentor people to, right, to bring you across the gap. Maybe it's an issue of social networks. Asian Americans, Asians, perhaps we aren't savvy enough, or we aren't networking correctly. Soft ties, weak ties. Maybe it's a pipeline issue. Maybe it's a sponsorship issue. Sponsorship referring to, again, you need more distinguished Asian Americans who can vouch for younger, more junior scholars that are coming up. Because I pointed out, these positions really only began in the 2000s for us. Could it be an issue of homophily, that there are gatekeepers? You know, you don't look like us, you can't be in our crew. You're over there, we're over here. And then prestige factors, right? Well, if we're supposedly model minorities and we all go to Ivy League schools, then why aren't we represented? You know, among other questions. So now, finally, I can talk about where we're at in terms of this evening. All of that context is important because when I'm sharing tonight with you that this book was a project in the making for I would say even more than 3 or 4 years. Originally, I was going to do it in interviews, as I mentioned, individually, and then I invited Daisy and the other co-editor, Amar Deep, a South Asian scholar. And the reason being, right, I had to abort and come up to save the project, so we said, okay, let's do an edited book. So the books feature, the professors featured in the book are Dr. Lin Goodwin, Dr. Suzanne SooHoo, Dr. Kioh Kim, Dr. Krishna Bista, George Sugai, Yali, you have all of them here in front of you. As an Asian American scholar, I'm always thinking about this because I'm always looking out for junior scholars, Asian American scholars, people who need opportunities, right? And it was with these considerations that I thought, in terms of a methodological approach, it would be awesome if we could honor the very few Asian American endowed professors we have. Like, just say, you know what, you're at the highest point. We salute you, thank you, continue the tireless work. We want to honor you. But also, it would be wonderful if we could do an edited book in a way that would allow their protégés and mentees, you know, give them an opportunity to publish. Because we know that publishing is currency in higher education. It's publish or perish, right? And so what better way to honor the senior scholars and then also allow junior scholars to get a chance to write, right? We gave them feedback on their chapters, they get a publication, and that helps their career. Because at some point in time, maybe they have aspirations to be endowed professors. We also wanted to allow them, as chapter contributors, to write in a way that spoke to their heart and head. We didn't give them much direction other than, we want you to tell a story. Tell us about your mentor. Chapter 2 is a special chapter personally and professionally, and it was well written. It's entitled Scholarship as Meditation, Lessons Calling Us to Theory and Action, and it's written by three, at the time, PhD students at Chapman University in Orange County, California. Now, I think two are on faculties. Tim is at Laverne University in LA, and Kevin is at South Dakota State, I think, or North Dakota, one of the Dakotas. And their mentor was Dr. Suzanne SooHoo. And Dr. SooHoo is a personal mentor of my own, very strong woman who recently said she's actually retiring. So again, it's kind of like this life cycle. Here she was like a trailblazer, right, endowed professor, and now she's retiring. The question will become, who will take her position? Or will the position be eliminated, right? Ultimately, that's up to the dean and their university. But the chapter contributors, her mentees, they brought up something very profound, and I have it up for us all to consider. She oftentimes, Dr. SooHoo, she oftentimes would talk to Tim, Charlotte, and Kevin and say, what could we know together that could not be known alone? And I think that's so poetic and profound, that we are stronger together than separate. And that's why their chapter, they engage in a trialogue. All three of them, not a dialogue, not a monologue, but a trialogue, three people talking about their mentor. And they talk about how Dr. SooHoo is such a humble person. She is kind. She is always present, right? If you come to her office, she looks you in the eye and you have her undivided attention. And they bring up this quote. And I think, you know, knowing Dr. SooHoo, I would agree. She's that way. She's very authentic. So that was one of the highlights in the book for me to, through the process, give feedback and finally, in its published form, to reread.
And probably my favorite chapter was chapter 11, Lucky to be Alive, Ming Ming Chiu's Persistent Creative Path via Computer Science Education and Statistics. And this was authored by his former student and now a colleague, Dr. Chen. And one of the themes that was particularly persistent in this chapter about Ming Ming was, or about Ming as he'd like us to call him, was his curiosity. And so this curiosity both got him in trouble, and it's also what got him where he is today. And so as someone who likewise is curious, I am inspired by his journey. So I wanted to share just a few short excerpts from Chen's chapter that really highlight his curiosity, both as a child and then getting into dealing with some of the stuff that he works on now using statistical discourse analysis. And so as a criminal justice, as a criminologist, that's of particular interest to me. So Chen writes, "At the precarious border between Chinatown and Little Italy in New York City, Ming Ming Chiu, please call him Ming, a poor, small boy, the shortest in his class, grew up surrounded by John Gotti's mafia, the ghost shadows, and the flying dragons. In sixth grade, Ming was walking along Mott Street when three ghost shadow gang members approached him. One grabbed his jacket and told him to walk over to a doorway. Ming politely said, 'No, thank you,' pushed the gang member away, and ran through oncoming cars onto Canal Street. He zigzagged for several more blocks, boarded an uptown train, and was relieved to see the doors close with no gang members in sight." He goes on to talk about Ming's childhood and how he was really, in large part, in charge at home, and how this was both a responsibility that he held pride for, but also a source of stress. So he goes on to talk about how his sister and he imposed a strict curfew on themselves. This would allow them to get out into the city, but they'd be home before their parents got home from work. So he talks about his train pass led him to traverse the city from the burning cars in Harlem to the glorious Sopranos at Lincoln Center, only $2 for the Wednesday afternoon back row. As his parents would not have approved, Ming and his sister self-imposed an 8 o'clock curfew to ensure they'd be home before their parents at 10:30 in the evening. So some of the work that he does now focuses, as I said, on SDA, or statistical discourse analysis. And so this is a methodological approach that analyzes statistically conversation. And so what it's doing is it's looking at where do breaks or pauses or what have you in conversation, certain speech patterns, what can we learn from those patterns? And so Ming has allowed this to eradicate corruption. And so one of the things that he's done is he's studied the music industry, and he's looked at songs that record companies have paid to have played more, and he's found that the patterns of play and also the marketing techniques behind those songs stand out from songs that are just naturally aired on a radio broadcast. Some stuff that he's doing right now that's current focuses on contact child sex offenders compared to fantasy child sex offenders. And as a criminologist, I find this particularly interesting. What he's doing is he's allowing us to use language to identify who in the sex offender world or realm is actually most likely to have contact with the children that they're approaching. And so naturally, we would regard both groups of people, fantasy and contact child sex offenders, abhorrent or horrific. But what he's attempting to do through this research is identify for the police who are the people who are actually most likely to make contact with these individuals. And so it's through patterns of speech or via text message that he's able to identify those predators who are actually likely to make contact with victims, as opposed to just be operating in a fantasy realm. And so what he's identified is that it's through the specific grooming process and self-divulsion, giving information about oneself, using the word I a lot. My history, my childhood, is a pattern that we see in people who then go on to actually make physical contact with their victims, as opposed to keeping things in the fantasy realm. And so Chen has now gone on to write this chapter about Ming, and he speaks so highly of him. At the very end, he says that at one point they had done a significant body of research that got national and international news coverage, so his mom saw a picture of him in the newspaper. And he says, "When my mom saw the newspaper photo of Ming and I, she said that was the proudest moment of her life. When my dad called and told me that, my eyes teared, and a voice from the bottom of my heart said, 'Thank you, Ming, for encouraging and supporting me to go forward with courage.'" So one of the things that I like about this chapter is it exemplifies the mentorship process, and so we now have a new scholar who hopefully will take other mentors under his wing and produce kind of the same cyclical body of productivity. So some central takeaways from working on this volume is humility is a central theme. As I mentioned with Ming's story, creativity and curiosity. And so one of the things that I like about his story is he took a lot of risks. One of the things I tell my students is what you're majoring in right now, what your degree is in, is most likely not what you're going to end up doing. And they feel very uncomfortable with that. And Ming is a perfect he exemplifies this, i.e. he moved from a variety of different fields. He was not he didn't feel constrained within one field, and he learned from each field that he was in. It enhanced his body of knowledge rather than limiting him. And then, as I mentioned, the idea of paying it forward.
At the end of doing a project like this, I oftentimes ask myself, well, what did we stand to gain? What did we gain from this book? Well, we have a foreword of the book, and we have an afterword. The afterword actually is written by my dean, a Puerto Rican scholar who was formerly an endowed professor. And we had the foreword by an African American junior, I would say junior, young, early career scholar. Dr. Freeman in the foreword talks about, right, because when you give a person, you know, ask them to write the foreword, you have to give them the book so they get to read it. And he wrote how this book really gives examples and demystifies how one becomes an endowed professor. He states, matter-of-factly, he wants to be an endowed professor. That's one of his aspirations. Great. It's wonderful. The end of the book, the afterword, Renee writes why he gave up his endowed position and he became a dean. And those bookends really do justice to the chapters of the book. Renee talks about that, yes, he could stay in his endowed position, get tons of money, have a nice salary, teach a few classes, but to him that seemed very selfish. He wanted to give back as a servant leader. So as a dean, he has a chance to serve more. Now that's fascinating to me, because in the chapter, in his afterword, Renee discusses how and why he applied for the position. Do you want to know why he applied for it? A mentor that looked like him, a Latinx scholar, said, why don't you become one? There's an opening. And he was a sponsor because it was a former, he had a connection to the chair, the endowment. And he said, look, there's this, come over here, you need to apply for this. Oh, but no, I don't want to. Renee, you need to. We need more Puerto Rican folk up here. Apply for it. He did it, right? He moved to Georgia. He was there for a short stint, and he, you know, upon reflecting. And now I believe that chair is now closed. So again, these questions about pipeline, sponsorship, why people, even access, like maybe he didn't even know that that position was open to apply for, is vital, I think, for the Asian American community in the field of education for these upper level positions. There was a sense of humility across all of them. And I don't think that's cultural. What I think, if I were to interpret the findings, and again, this is, you know, it's qualitative, it's messy. I don't think it's necessarily humility, while I think they are humble. I think it's something different. I think these scholars are so much about the work, their work does their talking for them. They don't need to petition and apply for these positions. Many times they're recruited. Will you come to our institution? Here's this shiny object. This will help you. Right? And let me explain, what do I mean by a shiny object? Typically, the endowed professorships, the history of these positions are they're reserved for full professors who have accomplished so much that they merit them. And that's how they're labeled and branded and they're used. But sometimes they're also beginning now to be recruitment tools for institutions, and some are more symbolic than material. What do I mean by that? Some don't have money attached to them. It's just a named professorship. Now, anyone on the street, they don't know if you're getting extra salary enhancements. They don't know if it's tied to an endowment. They just know you're the blah, blah, blah professor of urban education, right? Going back, I know I'm going kind of forward and backward, but Renee, my dean, my current dean, he was the afterword author. I mentioned, right, a mentor of his said, hey, Renee, you need to apply. But there's another thing I need to point out. When he was a professor, one of his biggest mentors was an African-American endowed professor. So what do I mean by, okay, so what, Nicholas? I think it shows, again, homophily, birds of a feather flock together. Scholars of promise tend to just naturally be with folks who are already doing that great work, right? And so I think for future research, we ought to consider pipelines and mentorship. And I think here is where Asian American studies, Asian Americans can really think things through really critically. Issues of inclusion and exclusion. What do I mean by that? Well, who do we mentor as Asian Americans? That's not to say we need to exclude all races and ethnicities and cultures that aren't like ours, aren't Asian American. It also doesn't mean that we always have to go on the inclusion side. I think we need to think seriously. Are we writing and working with Asian Americans? Are we in solidarity with other racial groups, Black Lives Matter, right? Other social movements? I share that because I would hate for the few scholars we have to train up a new generation, not in their own image and reflection, right, but in the image of, you know, some other group, because we, through the process, I think is very important that Asian Americans, senior scholars especially, mentor and train the next generation. Right, because if we don't, then our population goes extinct, right? And I do see promise in that, because in 2000, as I mentioned, that's kind of when we began. Each year, we see movement and trends where Asian Americans are being more represented. And that's a good thing. I think that's a good thing. Certainly, you have these folks. That's a good thing. A limitation in our study, again, we did a lot of this initial work through internet research, just going on websites to find people. And so I think the next stage would be to actually do a national survey. Reach out to each individual institution and say, please identify all of your endowed chairs, all of your distinguished professors, and we could look at that. There are some limitations certainly in the book. Like all books, you know, it took me 20 books in my career to really understand that phrase. Books are outdated the moment they're published, right? Like textbooks, our students, you learn a book and, you know, the science curriculum on rockets, you know, Elon Musk shot up a rocket up there, SpaceX, oh we got to redo the book, right? So there's certainly, the book is outdated when it came out. And it's outdated because these positions are dynamic. They're changing almost on a semester to semester basis. These are some professors who we believe are Asian American. And what I mean by we believe, because on their websites and their pictures and their names, we suspect they have they would self-identify as Asian Americans. Some of these professors we knew about and we reached out to, and they declined our offer, which I think is also a telling tale, because let's pretend Asian American endowed professor A is here, and we ask them, hey, we'd like to feature you in a book. Would you do that? They might be reluctant, right, from a humility standpoint, but then also, like, hey, I don't feel right asking one of my students to write about me, right? It's kind of self-serving. And I think it's also telling because these scholars are so busy that they don't really have time. They have bigger fish to fry, right?
So we didn't include everybody in the volume that we would have liked to. And then another question is, what about the social construction of race? And so as we identify Asian/American, this is an all-inclusive construction that includes people who are both Asian nationals, people who are Asian American, people who identify as Asian or Asian American. But yet again, this was in part a self-imposed identification on our part as we were initially searching for people to be included in the volume.
So Daisy and I are in the process of doing another book, and we are looking at racial battle fatigue in faculty, perspectives and lessons from higher education. And it's a natural process now because in this book, if you're not familiar, you've never heard of racial battle fatigue is this phenomenon of scholars of color who work in higher education getting tired because of the day-to-day racism that they experience. And it leads to health impairments, right? Headaches, physical ailments, mental health complications. The existing work, though, hasn't had an approach that we're taking. We're taking an approach of looking at context in the sense of including different racial, cultural, ethnic, and indigenous groups. So we look at Latinx, African Americans, Native Americans, non-tenure track people, because that's a source of stress. If you don't have tenure in your day-to-day, if you're an adjunct, that's added stress. And then also we're looking at different institutional types. Typically, the literature has looked at research one institutions. We're looking at community colleges, teaching colleges, and research colleges.
And so a lot of colleges have these diversity fellowships, or these diversity, they have different titles for them. Sometimes at one university I'm familiar with, it's named after the first African-American student who came to that college, so it's the Mary Miles Bibb Diversity Fellowship. And so these are 2 to 3, typically 1 to 3 year positions, faculty positions, usually a full teaching load, but they're not tenure track. And so one of the things that we're exploring in this volume is, are these positions good for scholars of color? Do they position them to then go on and secure tenure track positions? Or do they actually slow down that progress? So are there racial majorities who, after getting their PhD, go right into a tenure track position and thus are on that track more quickly? Or are they lingering or languishing, and people who are able to take these diversity fellowships, are they actually getting ahead? And not surprisingly, as you've probably heard this evening in terms of many of our findings, not surprisingly, what we are really sad to report is that these diversity-related fellowships don't seem to in any way help the people, the recipients thereof. In fact, they tend to slow them down. And so one of the voices or themes that we're hearing from the voices of the chapter authors who are writing these autoethnographic accounts of their experiences is that not only are they the diversity person at their school, they are who racial ethnic minority students gravitate towards for assistance,
for support for both emotional and academic needs. And they're also asked, in addition to their full teaching load, to give a number of workshops on diversity, to be on diversity committees, to be kind of the diversity spokesperson for the college. And this is not typically, as I mentioned, these are not tenure track positions, so one is not getting quote unquote credit for the extra work that this takes. And one of the things that chapter authors have stated is that many of the people who are asking them to take on all these additional responsibilities actually think that they're doing them a service. They think it's nice to ask them, oh, won't you be on this diversity committee, or won't you give this workshop on implicit bias, or won't you do this or that? But in fact, what they're doing is asking way more of them than is being asked of other faculty members.
You know, I start to think, what racial battle fatigue experiences do endowed professors have? Like, so you've reached this pinnacle, like the folks in our book. You've reached this pinnacle. I'm sure you're still experiencing anti-Asian racism, xenophobia. I suspect you're still a foreigner in your own land. I suspect that people think that you're a model minority, right? And so these are the logical questions I'm asking, and I hope folks you all consider too. And then lastly, this whole notion of career capital, symbolic or material, is the benefit mostly symbolic or material? When you reach this elevated status, people reach out to you. They want you to come to their campuses. They pay you, right, to consult. They pick your brain for your expertise. So, you know, I'm wondering the symbolism of it, as well as how knowledge is so much socially constructed and socially validated. I mean, think about it for a moment, folks. When you pick up a book at Barnes & Noble, Borders, Powell's, and you read the back, why do you think so many book covers have big names that say, "The best book since sliced bread," or "Publishers Clearinghouse says a wonderful read"? It's to validate that, right? And so it's the influencers. I mean, in the era of YouTube, it's this whole notion of influencers. But how does one become influential, right? How do Asian Americans become influential? Who is the face? I mean, we have those scholars. We know them, many of us, many at CUNY. Frederick Long, right? Among others, we know that Frank Wu's of the world, but how did they get to that stature? And who will be their replacements? And so I'd like to stop, and hopefully we can just talk about this and other things.